Welcome back and thank you for staying with us. The coronavirus pandemic has exposed the various cracks in the healthcare system.
And at a time when the Ministry of Health is grappling with many cases, now strategies like home care are now the go-to option.
Self-isolation means economic hardship.
And the high cost of treatment leaves many reluctant to get tested.
This is all contributing to the spread of the virus and has intensified the debate around the subsidized healthcare.
And Walter Mwesije has the details. Let's take a look.
Dr. Fiona Atuhebwe, an employee of the World Health Organization, contracted COVID-19 at her workplace in Congo, Brazzaville, where she is in charge of new vaccine introductions due out in April. Dr. Atuhebwe says she is lucky to be alive and also to be able to afford the best health care because after 4 months of nursing the disease, she is now dealing with post-recovery treatment.
People just hear she has been taken to Mulago. She's out of Mulago, full stop. They do not know what follows after Mulago. Because the hardest part is what follows after Mulago or after hospital. It is very, very difficult. I had issues with controlling my blood pressure. So meaning when I stood up, for example, I would automatically fall back down. So I have to take time when I get up from bed, first sit up and then stand up. I cannot just get up like I used to get up at the time. But by the time I came out, really, I was much better. I was just happy to be back to normal life.
And there is also the fact of dealing with severe depression.
And the depression was determined by so many factors. It's determined by people out there who do not know what people are going through.
She believes her post-care treatment surpasses 20 million shillings.
But you must have money enough. And I'm telling people, if you have a family of more than three people, have 100 million on your account.
But what is the actual cost of treatment? According to Dr. Charles Olaro, the Director of Health Services in charge of curative services, there are several cost drivers for COVID-19 treatment on all fronts for patients, healthcare workers, and health facilities. These include personal protective equipment, medicines, non-medical supplies like dustbins, garbage, polythene bags, oxygen and its delivery equipment, additional health workers, and feeding, among others.
Every time the person goes, you will put on $25 of a coverall, and then you will put $25,000 for a KN95.
Diagnosing COVID-19 starts with tests. In a government facility, you will have to part with about $50, approximately 183,000 shillings. And without at least $100, which is roughly 350,000 shillings, you cannot do a swab for your COVID-19 test in a private facility. Some people think the government charge should be further subsidized.
Especially during this time when people have lost their jobs, others are unemployed, as you can see the groups on the streets. Even me myself, I cannot afford to lose 180,000 just to go for a COVID test. Yet we have other problems at home.
At least if government could subsidize to around 40,000 or 25,000.
They can do like they have done for HIV, where these tests are given at free cost.
Even if government decided to waive off the testing fees, the current infection trend shows that at one time our public health facilities may stop admitting patients suffering from COVID-19. Now this means if you are accessing treatment for the same infection, you may have to meet some, if not all, the important costs for your treatment. And these are not limited to x-ray scans or consultation fees, which may go up or over 500,000 shillings. But this is just the beginning of the expense. Once you test positive, Dr. Olaro now breaks down the cost of managing a hospitalized patient in both private and government facilities.
On average, you spend 10 to 15 days. So for your full stay, you'll need about 7 million shillings. For those are really the patients who are mild to moderate. But if you look at now those who need high dependence services, on average per day is 1 million Uganda shillings. And the average stay is about 15 days. So 14 to 15 days, which means that you need about 14 million shillings for that. Now if you look at those who are critical, who are admitted in the intensive care unit, it needs 2.5 million shillings per day. About 10 to 15 days, you take about 30, 30 to 75 million shillings to take care of what? One patient. If you go to the private, definitely the cost is much more what? Like a ward admission, which government is charging, which would cost government about 500,000, it will cost you about 1.5 million shillings. And then high dependence, you'll have to pay 2.5 million what? Shillings, and an intensive care bed is between 3 million and 8 million what? Shillings.
What about those with insurance covers?
The different medical policies have limits. When you buy a policy, there are limits on the inpatient, there are limits on the outpatient. So you may find that if you're diagnosed with COVID, the treatment alone may exhaust your budget under that particular cover.
There is no specific time for recovery because the infection can cause multiple damage to several body organs, but most importantly, it impacts one's mental health.
And then we have people who are symptomatic, and those ones come out and think they can advise people who have been in ICU in Mulago. You think you can advise somebody who has been on oxygen, say, no, you'll be fine. It's not true, because it takes time.
Uganda has, for the last several days, recorded triple-digit numbers of infections per day, and experts warn of a sharp hike with the current political period and as we head into the festivities.
On COVID-19 cases registered and over 230 deaths in Uganda, the surging cases have left many at a point of reflection, wondering how the country got here and what exactly went wrong.
Tonight, Colonel Mugume speaks to the experts. He seeks for a way out of Uganda's current situation. Take a look.
James Saka's tenures at the National Information Technology Authority, NITA, has been described by many as a technological revolutionary decade. According to friends and workmates, Saka dedicated all his energies to lead the digital revolution in the country. But even when he retired in August 2020, his legacy could easily be traced. Coronavirus robbed him of all this. He's now no more. A tweet by Minister Frank Tumwebaze on the 9th of December would later announce his demise caused by a virus that's slowly claiming lives almost daily. Uganda is now counting close to 30,000 COVID-19 infections. Today, the country has reached a point where COVID-19 cannot be controllable, experts say.
At stage 4 of the pandemic, what does this mean? The transmission has reached uncontrollable levels, and there are different pockets of transmission.
But how did we get here? According to the experts from the Ministry of Health, the tough lockdown measures had controlled the spread of the virus in the beginning. But pressure mounted, thus compelling government to create a balance between safety and the social economy.
As we open up the high-risk activities so that we have economic and social well-being and livelihood, we are opening up not because we are safe, but we are opening up so that we can survive.
Despite continuous messages to the public on observing COVID-19 standard operating procedures, this has not been the case. The public has been reluctant, and this explains the surging cases.
And people were advised to have SOPs for churches and mosques. But when you see them, do you ever watch them on TV? The masks are under the nose. They speak, they pull the mask down here on the chin. So what happens? We are exposing people. And what happens in the church? We sing, we shout. When we are praying, we are talking all the time. You have many people talking at the same time. So if they are infected, the droplets that contain the virus are going around and we are infecting people. So even when you are a bit of a distance apart, when you're speaking and when you're singing, when you're shouting, the chances of transmission are higher. So we have the religious congregations. Then the weddings grew bigger. Then the funerals grew bigger.
If the public remains as reluctant as it is now, projections from the Ministry of Health indicate that Uganda is headed for 1,000 deaths in the first quarter of 2021 and that the curve may not be flattened anytime soon. And the only hope now lies in the treatment and the vaccine. Kanaru Mugume.
Well, thank you very much, Canary. Now, we must emphasize, there has never been a time like now when we must mind how ready our bodies are to fight against diseases.
Now, the rising number of COVID-19 are worrisome, but scientists continue preaching a boosted immunity substantially reduces the spread and the impact of the virus.
Luckily, there are simple ways that you can boost your immunity, as Dr. Grace Nambatia explains. Let's take a look.
At the Natural Chemotherapeutics Research Institute, simple foods are mixed and vital enzymes extracted to make immunity boosters, not just against COVID-19, but any other diseases. These foods are, however, readily available and can be consumed naturally at home without undergoing the chemical processes. The important thing is that one takes in nutrients that help keep their bodies healthy and ready to fight off infection.
Pineapples, oranges, lemons, ginger. Let's not just look at them. Let's learn to use them and use them efficiently. For example, pineapple, don't just eat and throw away. The middle part is very, very important. Scientifically, it has been established to have an enzyme called bromelain, and that bromelain can disorganize the coronavirus.
And a balance in what is consumed is emphasized.
And the simplest way to balance is colors. Foods have different colors. If you can take care to see that you've eaten some orange, some green, some, you're likely to find that the orange is maybe a carrot, the pinkish is chicken, that kind of thing. You will get adequate nutrition, and we should avoid too much sugar. By balancing, you know, you put in lemon. If something is so sugary, drink more water. And of course, we need to say exercises. Exercises also boost body immunity.
As confirmed positive COVID-19 cases go up in Uganda, it is becoming stressful for a population worried about how many lives could be lost if the spread of the virus is not stopped. Stress itself can suppress one's immunity and cause them to fall sick more easily.
You may eat all the best foods, do everything it takes, but then if you don't know how to manage stress, you will destroy everything.
Standing at nearly 30,000 cases and 225 deaths, researchers say coronavirus pandemic is yet to peak, and they expect the numbers to go higher during the Christmas season. Wearing a mask, maintaining social distance, and avoiding crowds goes without saying. To act or perish means taking responsibility to protect oneself and others around you.
As we come to the close, think about this. We have spent most of the year not traveling anywhere. But if you decide to travel upcountry, you could infect your loved ones. So much as you may not be infected, they could die from this disease.
If you think that breathing through a mask, I'm talking about a face mask, is uncomfortable and a nuisance, then think about this. Yourself trying to breathe through a ventilator, staring the cold chill of death in the face.
If you think that going out to party is fun, well, there's nothing funny about lying in a hospital bed alone and frightened.
Well, it's a small price to pay to keep yourself safe from the COVID-19, a lot cheaper than going to the hospitals that are charging exorbitant fees. Thank you for joining us. We'll now take a short break, but when we return, we'll be sharing with you the news from our respective stations. My name is Wadulo Mark Arnold, and from the team, we must say good night.